Cantor Audio presents Animal Weapons, The Evolution of Battle by Douglas J. Emlen. Narrated by Sean Runnette. I know not with what weapons World War III will be fought, but World War IV will be fought with sticks and stones. Albert Einstein. Preface. For as long as I can remember, I've been obsessed with big weapons, which is rather surprising given that I descend from a long line of Quakers. On field trips to the Natural History Museum, it wasn't birds or zebras that caught my eye. It was mastodons with curling tusks or triceratops with five-foot-long horns. In every room, it seemed, loomed another species with a crazy protrusion jutting from its head or from between the shoulder blades or from the end of its tail. Gallic moose wielded 12-foot-wide antlers, and arsinotheres had horns 6 feet long and a foot wide at the base. I couldn't peel my eyes from these creatures. Why were their weapons so big? As I grew, and in particular as I learned more about biology, I realized that big had little to do with absolute size. Extreme weapons were all about proportion. Some of the most magnificent structures are borne by tiny creatures. Hiding in drawer after drawer of dried, pinned specimens in museum archives, for example, are uncountable numbers of oddball species. Beetles with front legs so long they have to be folded awkwardly around the animal in order to shut the lid on the case, or horns so big the animals have to be mounted in the drawer sideways. Many species are so small that their weapons become apparent only with a microscope. Twisted tusks protruding from the faces of West African wasps, for example, or broad, branched antlers adorning the faces of flies. I began my career determined to study extreme weapons, so I set out to find the craziest, most bizarre animals that I could. I also wanted my research to take me someplace exotic. In my case, this meant the tropics, so I narrowed my search. My study animals needed to be easy to find in large numbers, to observe in the wild, and to rear in captivity. As fate would have it, the animals that best fit this bill were dung beetles. I resisted at first. After all, dung beetles lack the panache of elk or moose, and, well, they eat dung. Dung beetles were also a tough sell whenever I tried to explain what I did to anyone outside of biology. My father-in-law springs to mind. He's a retired U.S. Air Force colonel, and I'll never forget breaking it to him that I wanted to take his daughter with me to a remote field station in the thick of a tropical rainforest so I could watch dung beetles. But dung beetles really were the best animals for testing the ideas I wanted to test, and there were lots of them in the tropics. Squat, like little tortoises, these beetles were armed to the teeth with spectacular horns. Better yet, almost nothing was known about how these weapons were used, why they were so big, or why species differed so incredibly in the numbers and shapes of horns that they produced. To a biologist, that kind of unknown is intoxicating. Like exploring the depths of the ocean or outer space, I was going to plunge into the abyss of the biological void, and I was going to learn about extreme weapons in the process. 2 decades later, I remain just as awestruck by beetle weapons as I was that first year in the tropics. I've followed their stories to Africa, Australia, and throughout Central and South America. I've also had a chance now to step back from beetles, to consolidate the lessons learned by biologists studying a plethora of extreme weapons in animals ranging from moose flies and fiddler crabs to elephants and elk. These are the stories I set out to tell, weaving together for the first time the narrative of nature's most extravagant creatures. In the process of weaving their histories together, it became clear that there was another species that belonged in the mix. Humans. The more I sought common threads, themes uniting the stories of diverse animal species, the more apparent it became that these threads applied to our own weapons, too. In the end, my book about animal weapons evolved into a book about extreme weapons everywhere. I poured deeper into the literature surrounding our past, searching for the environments and circumstances in which our most elaborate weapons evolved. To my amazement, these circumstances truly were the same, and I realized I couldn't tell one story without telling the other. Back and forth I went, as the biology of animal weapons and our weapons fused, inextricably woven into a single tale. This is a book about extreme weapons. Let's just leave it at that. Extremes. It was a cold, clear mountain night. The Milky Way streaked across the sky. Jagged peaks loomed black against the starlight. A college buddy of mine and I were camping in Rocky Mountain National Park. It was early fall, peak of the rut for elk. I'd insisted we take the most remote campsite possible, and we'd pitched our tent as far away from the rest as we thought we could get away with. I wanted to be surrounded by aspen and cottonwood, not other people. Somewhere around 2 a.m., I jolted awake, sleep still spinning in my head. A gunshot? I sat there in the silence, listening. It came again. Crack! In an instant, I knew what was happening, and it was no gunshot. I shook Scott awake, and we bolted from the tent. Almost a ton of testosterone-driven rage exploded beside us in the blackness, not 20 feet away. Mature bull elk easily weigh in at 800 pounds apiece, and the two bulls locked in combat before us wouldn't even notice if they trampled a tent or its occupants in the scuffle. There we stood, shivering, bare feet burning in the new frost, squinting in awe at the shadowy beasts clashing beside us. The bulls circled, assessing each other, and then lowered their heads and slammed. Antlers clacked as they locked heads, gigantic silhouettes straining, grunting, gouging divots from the earth each time they lunged. Hindquarters whirled by our tent as they quick-stepped their ancient dance, oblivious to the world around them. In the end, we didn't get trampled, and our tent survived unscathed. But images from that September night 15 years ago stay etched in my mind. I still remember steam rising from their breath in swirling clouds against the dark shadows. I even remember the smell, thick and musky, from the oil glands on the bulls' faces. By any account, elk are magnificent beasts, icons of power and beauty. But most of what impresses us sticks out from the tops of their heads. It's the antlers that inspire our wonder. The weapons. The racks of elk, red deer, moose, and caribou have added regal splendor to the walls of royal halls for centuries. Indeed, no self-respecting chateau or castle would be complete without them. Antler-wielding stags are one of the most pervasive symbols in heraldic coats of arms, and mounted heads with antlers or horns grace the fireplaces of innumerable hunters' dens, sporting goods stores, restaurants, and bars, reflecting silent glory upon the ones who slayed them. Obsession with animal weapons is nothing new. The earliest known paintings attributable to our species, inked onto the smoky walls of caves more than 30,000 years ago, feature the branching antlers of stags, curved mastodon tusks, and rhinoceros and buffalo horns. Today, antlers and horns are embedded into the brand strategies of corporations ranging from single malt scotch, Glenfiddich, the Dalmore, and other spirits, Jägermeister, Moosehead Lager, to farm equipment, John Deere, firearms, Browning, automobiles, Porsche, Dodge, clothing, Abercrombie & Fitch, mountaineering gear, Mammut, sports franchises, Manitoba Moose, St. Louis Rams, Milwaukee Bucks, Texas Longhorns, and even pharmaceutical companies, Janssen, and investment firms, The Hartford, Merrill Lynch. No matter how you stack it, we love antlers and horns. But why are antlers so impressive? What is it that captures our imagination and awe? It's not just that they're weapons. Most animals have weapons of one sort or another. Tigers and lions have claws, eagles have talons, snakes have fangs, wasps have stingers, and even our household dogs have a respectable set of teeth. What strikes us about antlers is that they are big. The rack on a bull elk is 40 pounds of bone erupting from the head in two curved beams, each adorned with as many as 7 sharp tines. In the largest bulls, antlers tower 4 feet above the male and arch backward over half the length of the rest of his body. That's massive. And although most of us never stop to think about it, we all know at some level that anything that big must also be expensive. In fact, the price bulls pay for their antlers is extraordinary, and they pay this price again and again since they shed and regrow their antlers anew each year. Unlike the rest of the body, which takes years to grow to adult size, antlers in even the largest bulls go from nothing to full size in just a few months. Antlers grow faster than any other bone in any animal, and this record speed racks up record energetic costs. Estimates from antlers of a related species, fallow deer, show that while males are growing antlers, they more than double their daily energetic needs. In addition, growing antlers suck up so much calcium and phosphorus, minerals that make up the bone, that the males cannot possibly get enough from their food. Instead, they leach these vital minerals out of other bones and shunt them to the antlers, depleting the rest of their skeleton so severely that they experience a seasonal form of osteoporosis. Their bones get weak and brittle at precisely the time of year, the rut, when they must hurl themselves against 800-pound rivals in incessant battles for access to females. By the end of the rut, the males will have fought so often and so hard that they have lost a quarter of their body weight, and they emerge from this season battered, starved, and brittle-boned. If they cannot replenish their reserves in the few short weeks before winter, they'll starve. Such is the reality of extreme animal weapons. Brutal and beautiful, extreme weapons have cropped up repeatedly during the unfolding of the history of life. All told, some 3,000 species now wield them. That's a drop in the bucket, considering there are 1.3 million described types of animal, but it's a collection packed with remarkable creatures. Early champions include the horns of triceratops, titanotheres, and trilobites, the tusks of mammoths and dolphin, and the racks of Irish elk. Today, extreme weapons are wielded by walruses, antelope, whales, crabs, shrimp, beetles, earwigs, plant bugs, and flies, to name just a few. The weapons themselves can be matted hair, bone, teeth, or chitin, and they take any number of different forms. Some, for example, are overgrown versions of an existing structure, like a tooth or a leg. Others appear to have arisen de novo, as new bumps or knobs that became so large they formed their own distinct structure. In absolute size, they run the gamut from quarter-inch antlers on a New Guinean fly to 16-foot tusks on a mastodon. Yet relative to the size of the individuals who carry them, all of these weapons are massive. This is a book about extreme weapons, structures so gargantuan and bizarre they look like they shouldn't be possible, so awkward that the animals who bear them ought to tip over or trip or get tangled each time they attempt to move. Why are these weapons so big? What happens to animals once their weapons get this big? And is there such a thing as too big? To answer these questions, we'll delve into the murky forests and mountainsides where animals do battle, immersing ourselves in the details of their lives in order to identify patterns, things these wildly different species all share in common, and things that illuminate the logic behind such extraordinary animal forms. We humans are animals too, and no book on extreme weapons would be complete without an examination of our own arsenals. We'll see that the parallels between animal weapons and manufactured weapons run deep. In both cases, the vast majority of weapons are relatively unimpressive and small. But here and there, circumstances arise that shatter the norm, sparking bursts of rapid escalation in weapon size called arms races. Very specific factors must fall into place before weapon evolution launches into one of these races. And it turns out that the same special circumstances triggering arms races in animals also prompt humans to manufacture bigger and bigger weapons. Once started, both sorts of races quickly lead to extreme weapon forms, staggering in both size and cost. And along the way, they each progress through the same sequence of recognizable stages. Analogous circumstances even bring about their collapse, as huge weapons come crashing down and the race dissolves. Ultimately, we'll see that our animal counterparts can teach us a surprising amount about ourselves. Animal Weapons is necessarily a book about evolution, the gradual turnover within populations that leads to changes in animal form over time. At its most basic, this evolutionary process is a simple one. Entities exist in multiple forms. They vary from individual to individual, and their individual characteristics are transmitted from one generation to the next. The transmission of this information is efficient, but it's not perfect, and mistakes get made along the way. Errors in the transmission of information lead to new characteristics, novel variations that crop up in the population from time to time. New variants now exist side by side with earlier forms, competing with them for resources and reproduction. And only some of them will persist. Whenever individuals differ in how successful they are at propagating their kind, evolution occurs. This can be due to chance, random deviations in the reproductive success of types, or it can result from selection. Individuals with some characteristics perform better than individuals with other characteristics, and as a result, they leave behind more copies of their kind. Such a process, iterated over generations, results in the eventual replacement of inefficient with more efficient forms. The population evolves as the least effective types are culled and replaced by more effective types. As transmission errors yield new types of individuals, they inject fresh forms into the mix. If the new individuals do worse than the rest, they gradually disappear. If they do better, then the new forms can spread, replacing earlier forms in the process. This turnover is evolution. Huge animal weapons look too awkward to be favored by selection, and in the vast majority of cases, this appearance isn't misleading. Big weapons are ungainly, and most individuals fare poorly with them. For most weapons in most species, selection favors modest size and minimal cost. Enough tooth to bite or grab prey, for example, but not enough to slow you down or impair your ability to maneuver. What this actually means is that selection on weapons is balanced. Bigger weapons may be better for stabbing or biting, but they are also more expensive to produce and more difficult to carry. The result is a tenuous balance, much like a game of tug-of-war, which accounts for the multitude of unimpressive weapons adorning the vast majority of animal species. Yet every so often this balance is tipped. Here and there, sprinkled across the tree of life, are animal lineages where modesty of proportion was cast aside. The evolution of weapons in these species surged forward unencumbered. Gone were the shackles of balancing selection, and all that remained was selection favoring bigger and bigger weapon sizes. Here, individuals with the most grotesque or extreme armaments beat opponents with smaller weapons. In so doing, they secured opportunities to breed. Their progeny, as impressive in their weapons as their parents, quickly replaced earlier forms and advanced the population another notch in weapon size. As soon as the next new innovation arose, an even larger or more complex variant of the existing design, the process repeated itself. Again and again, individuals with the newest and biggest weapons won, replacing those with earlier and smaller forms, and this process pushed the population still further on the path to extreme. In short, the weapons of these species got caught up in an arms race. Weapons swept into arms races begin small, but over time they get bigger and bigger, increasing in size faster and faster. So too, this book will begin with the small and proceed through ever greater weapon extremes, assembling the biology of arms races in stages. Part 1, Starting Small, examines the mechanism of selection and the ways that weapon designs change through time. This is followed by a brief discussion of balance, the reason selection so often tugs weapons toward smaller and bigger sizes simultaneously, and of why this balance occasionally tips. The biggest animal weapons result from males competing with rival males over access to females. Part 2, Triggering the Race, explores why this is true and how competition leads to arms races. Competition drives rapid evolution of huge weapons, but only when two additional conditions are met. All three ingredients are necessary to trigger a race. By exploring each of them in detail, I'll reveal for the first time the essential logic of huge weapons, explaining why these structures evolve in some species but not others, and why they attain such incredible proportions. Part 3, Running Its Course, explores what happens after an arms race is triggered, describing in detail the predictable sequence of stages characteristic to the evolution of nature's biggest weapons. Staggering costs, deterrence, and cheating all appear as intuitive milestones along the way, and costs and cheaters erode payoffs to huge weapons in ways that can set the stage for collapse. Appreciating how arms races unfold reveals a great deal about the weapons themselves, about the conflicts and contests surrounding their use, and about what happens when weapon evolution goes too far. Finally, Part 4, Parallels, tackles head-on the evolution of extreme weapons in our own checkered past. Although I am a biologist, not a military historian, and this book is primarily concerned with diversity and extravagance in animal weapons, the parallels with our own armaments are too striking and exciting to ignore. Every element of arms races, from the conditions critical to launching a race to the sequence of stages unfolding along the way, lends itself to comparisons between animals and people. Manufactured weapons are not inherited in the strict sense. Instructions for their production are not encoded in DNA, and they are assembled in factories rather than wombs. The competitions they resolve are less likely to yield opportunities to mate, and success is often measured in currencies rather than increased numbers of offspring. Nevertheless, human weapons change in shape, capability, and size over time, and the directions of this change are sculpted by forces of selection astonishingly similar to the forces shaping weapon evolution in animals. Arms races are arms races, and the natural history of extreme weapons, it turns out, is precisely the same. Part 1. Starting Small. 1. Camouflage and Armor. It is November 1969 and dark. Moonlight glints off of tree branches, casting small shadows beside pebbles and twigs on the fresh dirt. A tiny metal door opens and two mice rush out, like gladiators released into the Roman Colosseum. They dash into the darkness in search of cover, but there isn't any, and only one of the mice will survive this race. Above them, an owl sits on a perch, watching. Its head snaps into position as it spots a mouse, and with a graceful swoop, utterly devoid of sound, it attacks. One moment, both mice are running, the next, just like that, one of them is gone. Droplets of blood on the dirt are the only evidence of what has occurred. 6 concrete enclosures lie side by side, encased in chicken wire to keep the owls from escaping. 12 feet wide and 30 feet deep, they are more vast to a mouse than Mile High Stadium is to you or me. In 3 of them, the soil is rich and dark, imported from a nearby field. In others, the soil is sandy and pale, trucked in from coastal dunes. Otherwise, the enclosures are the same, and each houses an owl, patiently waiting. Over and over, the race is repeated, as pairs of mice, one brown, one white, sprint across the dirt. All told, almost 600 mice will rush into the South Carolina night, all to answer one question. Which color mouse will the owls catch first? Owls eat astonishing numbers of mice. When owls feed, they pack fur and bones and other indigestible parts of their prey into their gizzards, coughing them up later as dense little pellets that they spit onto the ground. Diligent biologists can harvest these pellets and pick through them, counting and identifying bones, to reconstruct an owl's diet on any given night. A single owl can eat 4 or 5 mice a night, and well over 1,000 in a year. Scaled up to the landscape, owls kill between 10% and 20% of mouse populations in a typical year. Up to 1/5 of all mice die in the talons of an owl. Despite the brutal toll exacted by owls and other predators, Oldfield mice thrive across the southeastern United States. They live in abandoned corn and cotton fields, along hedgerows, in forest clearings, and throughout all sorts of shrubby fields. These mice also live along coastal beaches and sand dunes tufted with coarse grasses, and they have colonized many of the small offshore barrier islands of Alabama and northern Florida. In the mid-1920s, Francis Bertotti Sumner, the leading mouse biologist of his day, heard about the strange white mice of Florida beaches. He worked his way across their range, meticulously sampling animals from population after population. Some he brought into his lab to breed, but most he killed, stretching their little pelts for archiving and museum collections. The pattern he documented was striking. Mice from inland populations, stubble fields and clearings across Alabama, Tennessee, South Carolina, Mississippi, Georgia, and interior Florida, were dark brown in color, much like that of other field mouse species found elsewhere in the United States. But along the coasts and out on the sandy offshore islands, the mice were white. And if you marched a line from inland to coast, there was an abrupt transition separating brown mice from white. The boundary fell about 40 miles inland from the shore, and it tracked the coast like a contour line on a map. Sumner noticed that around this transition zone, the soil also changed color. Inland, the soil was loamy and dark, filled with organic detritus from decaying vegetation. Near the shore, soils were sandy and white. In some cases, mice lived on dunes of bleached sand so bright they resembled giant mounds of sugar. 90 years later, Lynn Mullen and Hopi Hoekstra, biologists at Harvard University, retraced Sumner's steps and sampled the populations again. 1,000 mouse generations separated the two samples, but the pattern held. Soil color changed abruptly from brown to white, and mice matched this transition with a shift in fur color. Brown mice lived inland, and white mice lived on the beaches. In all other respects, inland and beach mice are similar. They make the same kind of burrows, for example. They cut in at an angle, leveling off into a horizontal nest chamber about a foot below ground. Many of them also make an escape hatch, a vertical tube that extends from the nest chamber straight up, stopping just an inch below the surface. If a snake or weasel pokes into their burrow entrance, they can explode through the thin soil capping this shaft to escape. Inland and beach mice eat the same foods, including insects, seeds, and the occasional berry or spider. By all metrics except color, these mice are the same. So why are the coastal mice white and inland mice brown? This was the question Donald Kaufman sought to answer with his gladiator-esque doctoral dissertation experiment that November back in 1969. Over and over, night after night, he released dark mice and white mice into cages side by side. Each time the owl snatched one of the mice, Kaufman recorded which one died and which survived. He showed that both soil color and mouse color mattered. When the mice dashed across dark soil, the white mouse was most often taken. When the soil was pale, the pattern was reversed. Owls snatched the darker mouse. There were additional nuances to the owl's behavior. For example, on the darkest nights, the pale mice fared especially poorly on the dark soil. Their white fur contrasted starkly with the blackness of their surroundings. On the other hand, bright moonlit nights and light soils made the dark mice stand out most sharply. Mouse survival depended to some extent on ambient moonlight and local conditions, but overall the pattern was clear. Mice whose fur color contrasted with their backgrounds got eaten. Hopi Hoekstra and her colleagues completed this story by tracking down the genes and even the particular mutation to these genes responsible for fur color in mice. Once Hoekstra's team knew the molecular machinery responsible for genetic variation in mouse color, they could reconstruct precisely how mice evolved in response to recent changes in the direction of natural selection. Most old field mice are brown, and this color is favored by selection across the majority of fields inhabited by this species. At some point in the past, possibly as recently as a few thousand years ago, mice spread into open areas along both the Gulf and Atlantic coasts, where they dug their burrows into sand dunes and grassy embankments. Beach mice now raced across a vastly different background than their inland ancestors, and in these new environs, dark mice got plucked from the sand. By chance, some of the beach mice carried in their DNA new mutations to one or both of two genes involved in the production of dark pigments. Mice inheriting these mutations carried copies of the pigment-influencing genes that were just a little bit different from the copies carried by other mice. Alternative versions of a gene are known as alleles. And as a result, they developed with lighter fur. Mice bearing the new alleles survived better than mice inheriting the ancestral versions of the genes, and these survivors populated the beaches with their pups. Over time, mice with the new alleles increased in frequency, while those with the original alleles disappeared, and the result was an evolutionary shift from dark to white. Camouflage might seem an odd place to begin this book, but weapons come in many forms, and not all of them function offensively. A U.S. Army infantry soldier marching into conflict carries all sorts of gadgets that contribute to his or her efficacy in battle. Not counting specialized weapons such as grenade launchers or squad automatic weapons, SAWs, the primary weapon is an M4 carbine assault rifle with removable bayonet. Along with this, soldiers carry fragmentation grenades, knives, food, water, and first aid kits. They wear body armor, vests with plates of finely woven Kevlar designed to protect against bullets and heat, a helmet, and cloth uniforms, camo, with color patterns designed to blend with the surrounding landscape. Many of these items function for defense rather than offense, but they are no less critical to troop success in combat. For this reason, they can be considered weapons. Although this book is principally about extreme weapons, the biggest tools in nature's arsenals, it begins with these other weapon types, including animal analogs to camo and armor, which we'll cover in this chapter, and to lightweight and portable small arms, which we'll get to in Chapter 2. Each of these animal examples has been studied unusually thoroughly, providing clear insights into the processes of selection and evolution. All of them also have intuitive parallels with man-made manufactured weapons. Obviously, blending with backgrounds is essential for soldier survival for precisely the same reasons that it is in mice. Imagine conducting a night operation wearing white winter camo. In fact, in 2003, the U.S. Army used a process not unlike Kaufman's experiment with owls to determine the most effective camouflage patterns for our troops. More than a dozen color and pattern types were assessed against urban, desert, and woodland environments to identify uniforms least likely to stand out. Some of these tests were conducted at night, where they showed, just like Kaufman, that being too dark on moonlit nights could be deadly. Modern enemy soldiers, it turns out, are a lot like owls. They have phenomenal nighttime vision, thanks to the spread of night vision goggles and other technologies. As a result, black has been eliminated from most camouflage patterns. Ideally, the uniform selection process should have unfolded just like owls selecting for mismatched mice, with the population, in this case the army, evolving toward the best camouflage possible. Unfortunately, politics and the economics of mass production intervened. Rather than choose several different types of uniforms, each the best available for a particular habitat, the army opted for a single universal camouflage pattern, UCP. This may have solved logistical problems of production and distribution, but it also caused our troops to sometimes stand out when they were supposed to be blending in. After all, the solution with mice was two colors, not one, and the reality of diverse combat habitats is that no one pattern blends well in all places. It didn't take long for our troops to complain, and by 2009 it was obvious to everyone that the UCP was performing terribly in Afghanistan. The Army then rushed to develop a new pattern, called Operation Enduring Freedom Camouflage Pattern, OCP, for soldiers deployed in Afghanistan, which it began issuing in 2010. Special Forces soldiers, incidentally, are not subject to the same constraints of mass production, and these units have diverse and effective uniforms to choose from, depending on the mission. Military units in other countries also base pattern choices on advanced tests of detectability. The brutal reality of life and death on the battlefield has provided a sort of natural selection for military uniforms. Many versions are tried, some perform better than others, and patterns performing the best are usually selected for further use. Despite various hiccups along the way, few would disagree that modern uniforms are vastly improved over those worn in earlier wars. World War II uniforms were better than those of World War I, and uniforms today are better than those used in Korea or Vietnam. From lizards and desert beetles that look a little like pebbles to giant tropical katydids resembling decaying leaves, camouflaged animals are evolutionary legacies of the same basic process, natural selection by visually searching predators. Predators don't just drive their prey to match colors with their backgrounds. They drive them to behave in new ways. When and how an organism moves can influence how vulnerable it is to predators. Animals that panic, dashing from their hiding places at the wrong time, or animals that walk or fly with the wrong gait, can break camouflage with deadly consequences. A leaf mimicking katydid would stand out if it whirred through a forest clearing in broad daylight. In fact, these katydids forage at night. During the daytime, they rest on branches nestled amid similar-looking leaves. If they do need to move in the daytime, they lurch with a swaying gait just like the back-and-forth flutter of a leaf in the breeze. Place one of these animals on an exposed, flat table, and this gait looks absurd. Place it on the branch of a bush, and the animal vanishes. The katydid's movements, combined with its shape and color, make it almost indistinguishable from the surrounding leaves. Resembling a leaf is a relatively passive defense, hardly a weapon proper, as is mouse fur blending with soil. Other animal defenses are much more formidable. Many animals use chemical weapons against their predators, either synthesizing toxins or extracting and sometimes modifying toxins from their food. Some caterpillars ooze droplets of poison from glands near the bases of tiny barbed needle-like hairs. Poison dart frogs pack toxins into their skin, foam grasshoppers disgorge foul-tasting bubbles from their armpits, and bombardier beetles spray jets of exploding acid from their anuses. Still other animals use armor to protect themselves. Like the jointed metal breastplates and shields sported by Roman centurions and medieval knights, many animals cover their bodies with tough plates of compacted hair, bone, or chitin, the main ingredient of insect and crab exoskeletons. Turtles and crabs may be the most familiar examples, but armor plates also protect armadillos, pangolins, pill bugs, and tortoise beetles, and similar shells protected the extinct glyptodonts and ankylosaurs as well. My personal favorite among the wild array of defensive weapons are spikes and spines that jut from the flanks and backs of prey. Blades of bone or chitin sharp enough to puncture the mouths of predators and tear delicate linings of digestive tracts. Dagger-like spines protect all sorts of animals, ranging from porcupines and hedgehogs to spiny crabs, long-spined porcupine fish, and katydids. Three-spined sticklebacks swim in shallow waters along the coasts of Europe and North America. These finger-sized fish rely on both sharp spines and armor to protect them from predators. Rigid spines project along their back and from their pelvis, and a row of bony plates adorns their flanks. Here, as with old field mice, biologists understand both the genetic basis for variation in defensive traits, the genes responsible for heritable variation in spine length and plate size or number, and they understand how this variation has contributed to rapid weapon evolution in the face of natural selection. This time, however, the traits are rigid, bony outgrowths rather than pigments altering the color of fur. Understanding how these weapons evolve sets the stage for the much larger outgrowths we'll consider in later chapters. As with all evolutionary tales, the stickleback story begins with variation. Some sticklebacks invest more in defensive weaponry than others, resulting in fish-to-fish differences in the length of pelvic spines and in the size and number of body armor plates. Not surprisingly, this variation in weapon size influences fish survival. Long spines make sticklebacks difficult to swallow. Think splintered chicken bones lodged in a dog's throat. And armor plates protect sticklebacks whenever predatory fish make the mistake of trying to bite them. Almost 90% of attacks on sticklebacks fail. But before spitting them out, predators chew sticklebacks rather harshly. A stickleback's armor plates act like shields, reducing the extent of injuries from these bites. While most sticklebacks live in the ocean, where predators are common, some inhabit freshwater lakes, and here their evolutionary story is different. Ocean levels fluctuate greatly over time, and during periods of high water, fish spill into inland reservoirs, where they end up trapped as the water recedes. Inland fish experience very different patterns of selection from their marine ancestors, and in lake after lake, their weapons have changed as populations adapted to their new locales. Fossils provide a roadmap of this weapon evolution. In fact, so many stickleback fossils have been preserved that they provide an almost unparalleled paleontological record of change in weapon size through time, as layer upon layer of fish corpses piled into the mud at the bottoms of lakes. Michael Bell, a biologist at Stony Brook University, studies this temporal progression of fish in a Nevada lake bed, where he and his colleagues reconstructed approximately 100,000 years of stickleback evolution in 250-year slices. In the beginning, well, the first 80,000 years of their 100,000-year window, Nevada lake sticklebacks had almost no protective weapons. Only one dorsal spine, rudimentary pelvic spines, and very few lateral plates. But then, 84,000 years into the time sequence, this type of stickleback was replaced entirely by armored sticklebacks, meaning three long dorsal spines and full pelvic spines. Bell suspects that marine fish flooded into the lake around this time because both forms co-occurred for about 100 years before the early fish type disappeared. Remarkably, over the following 13,000 years, the defensive structures in this new fish regressed. In graded steps through time, the spines got shorter and shorter until by the end of this period, the new sticklebacks resembled the earlier form that they'd replaced. Lake-bound fish lost their weapons. Today, sticklebacks in many lakes lack defensive weapons. Dolph Schluter and his students at the University of British Columbia found that lake habitats have far fewer predators than marine habitats, and this appears to relax the pattern of natural selection for larger plates and longer spines. With fewer predators, lake fish benefit less from large weapons than marine fish. Armor also costs more in lakes than it does in the ocean. Low freshwater concentrations of the ions necessary for bone growth mean that fish pay a higher price for mineralizing bony plates in lakes. Unarmed sticklebacks are larger as juveniles and begin breeding sooner than their armed counterparts. In freshwater, it appears, the costs of long spines and large plates are steeper than the benefits they provide. Of course, every story has exceptions, but with sticklebacks, the exception proves the rule. Dan Bolnick has been studying sticklebacks in Lake Washington, where fish have much bigger weapons than in other lakes. Bolnick found that this shift in armor happened very recently. Fish samples collected prior to the 1960s had reduced armor typical of other lake sticklebacks. Efforts to stem pollution in this lake resulted in a dramatic improvement in the transparency of the water, and in these especially clear waters, introduced trout began to feed in earnest on sticklebacks. More predators translated almost immediately into bigger weapons. Since the beginnings of recorded history, soldiers have sought protection from enemy weapons. Their armor mirrors the armor of stickleback fish and other animals, evolving for similar reasons and in surprisingly similar directions. The earliest forms of body armor were the shield, made originally from animal hide and later from leather stretched over wood, and protective clothing made from leather, padded fabric, wicker, or wood. Over time, as the technology of weapons changed, so did the shapes and styles of protective body armor. The first manufactured weapons were sharp, fire-hardened pointed sticks and spears tipped with flint blades. Napped flint could slice flesh, but blades shattered easily. Stiffened leather provided adequate protection against flint for thousands of years. Metallurgy brought with it tougher weapons, first bronze, which was soft and dulled quickly, and later iron. And against these weapons, leather armor was not as effective. Armorers began attaching metal rings or scales to the outsides of leather garments to block against the stabbing or slicing blows of metal-tipped pikes and swords. Ancient Greek soldiers wore a leather cuirass covered with front and back plates of hammered bronze. And Roman legionnaires wore leather cuirasses stitched with metal plates arranged in overlapping tiers, much like the scales of a fish. These warriors also wore helmets and carried bronze shields. By the time of the Crusades, 1100 to 1300 CE, protective shirts of mail, intricately linked chains of iron rings, had become standard attire for battle in Europe. Mail could block penetration from most strikes by metal blades, but shock from the impact was still severe. Soldiers often wore thick clothing of padded fabric or leather underneath mail. On top, they added scaled metal and leather cuirasses and helmets. Soon, plates of iron were added to vulnerable areas such as the elbows, shoulders, and legs. By the end of the 14th century, full suits of plate armor had replaced mail. Think knights in shining armor. Plate armor predominated until the 16th century, when its use in warfare was rendered obsolete by gunpowder and firearms. From the beginning, the evolution of protective, manufactured armor was shaped by a balance between benefits and costs. As weapons became more dangerous, the thickness and toughness of armor increased, but so did its bulk and weight. On the one hand, armor could protect a soldier, but on the other, it restricted his movements and slowed him down. A suit of chainmail weighed up to 50 pounds, not counting the heavy leather beneath it. A helmet alone could weigh 20 pounds, and helmets were so hot and suffocating that knights generally carried them on the pommel of their saddles until the last minutes before battle. Plate armor was a huge burden. Getting knocked over or unhorsed could mean death for a knight, since he couldn't get back up without assistance. By the end of the 16th century, crossbows and longbows had already called the efficacy of armor into question. Arrows striking straight on could penetrate, and the spread of gunpowder sealed its fate. As with the bony plates of lake-bound sticklebacks, once the benefits disappeared, armor was no longer worth the price. Although plate armor thick enough to stop a bullet was possible, nobody could wear it because the plates were too ungainly and heavy. So body armor all but disappeared from the battlefield for 400 years, until a new invention, Kevlar. In armor, we see all of the processes that matter for the evolution of extreme weapons. Individuals vary in the extent of their armament. These differences in weapon size affect the performance of their bearers, survival growth and reproduction in sticklebacks, and survival in soldiers. And as a result, the sizes and shapes of these weapons evolve rapidly and dramatically over time. Weapons such as armor come at a price. And sometimes, when this cost is high enough, individuals with small weapons fare better than those with big ones. Indeed, most of the time, for most weapons, bigger is not better. 2. Teeth and claws. Mountain lions are still common where I live in Montana, and for many Montanans, these cats are part of why we choose to live here. There's a tiny rush you feel every time you step out into the wilderness, a reminder that in some places we're actually not the top of the food chain. I had my first face-to-face encounter with a mountain lion this past December, hiking on the ridge behind my house. I'd known they were there, having seen paw prints in fresh snow on countless winter mornings, and from stumbling upon buried kills in the forest nearby. Lions cover a carcass with pine needles and branches so they can come back to it later. I also knew they were there because I was actively looking for them. A few years before, I'd placed a motion-activated trail camera next to a little spring in a ravine behind my house. Each week, I hike up the mountain to the spring to swap out the memory stick, and then sort through the thousands of pictures of magpies, deer, skunks, bears, eagles, and, of course, mountain lions. That morning last December, I was coming over the hill and starting down to the spring when my dog tore ahead of me. The cat he was chasing leapt to the nearest pine, shot up.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.